Radha Gopal Krishna Temple, Bahrain, Middle East. This is Balaram Desh, 1/5/2003. This is Radha Gopal Krishna Temple. This is Srimad Bhagavatam class. Canto 11, Chapter 3, Text 22, Srimad Bhagavatam class.
Oh. Paramananda Madhavam Sri Chaitanya Swabha. Satya Bhagavatam Dharma
Yes.
Accepting the bona fide spiritual master as one's life and soul, and worshipable deity, the disciple should learn from him the process of pure devotional service. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari, the soul of all souls, is inclined to give himself. To his pure devotees. Therefore, the disciple should learn from the spiritual master. Therefore, the disciple should learn from his spiritual master to serve the Lord without duplicity and in such a faithful and favorable way that the Supreme Lord, being satisfied, will offer himself to the faithful disciple. Report according to Srila Sridhar Swami. The Lord's tendency to give himself to his pure devotee is demonstrated in the case of Bali Maharaj, who sacrificed his pure kingdom. According to Srila Sridhar Swami, the Lord's tendency to give himself to his pure devotee is demonstrated in the case of Bali Maharaj, who sacrificed his universal kingdom for the pleasure of Lord Vamanadeva. Lord Bhavana was so pleased by the selfless surrender of Bali Maharaj. The Lord became the doorman in the palace of Bali, who was reinstalled as the great leader in the universe. Srila Jiva Goswami comments that the spiritual master is to be considered the Atma or the very life of the disciple, since real life begins when one is initiated by a bona fide spiritual master. Although one may experience many seemingly wonderful or important events in a dream, one's real life begins when he wakes up. Similarly, since the spiritual master gives birth to the disciple by awakening him to spiritual life, a bona fide disciple understands that his spiritual master is the very basis of his life. According to Srila Jiva Goswami, the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the reservoir of all pleasure. And thus the Lord's giving himself to a pure devotee indicates that such devotee becomes immersed. Ecstasy. In this connection, there is the following Shruti mantra: Ananda Dhimani Bhutani Jayante. Indeed, it is from the All Blissful Supreme that all these creatures have come into being. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur has further pointed out that when the Lord possesses his power, bestows his own self upon a pure devotee, such a fortunate devotee can actually see the Lord, touch him, and directly engage in his service. According to the Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, one should never consider one's spiritual master to be mundane or on equal level with oneself. One should see the spiritual master as being always under the shelter of the lotus feet of his Always under the shelter of lotus feet of the Supreme Lord, one should never try to engage the spiritual master and one's own personal service with the mentality of lording it over the spiritual master and attaining through him some material gain. One who is actually advancing will become more eager to serve the spiritual master, and thus such a disciplined experience, such a disciple experiences the pleasure of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Hari Bol! Srila Rupa Goswami has delineated four preliminary requisites for advancement for the sincere disciple. Gurupada Sayastasma Krishna Dikshari Shikshanam Vishram Bena Guru Seva Sadhu. Guru Parasayas Tasmat Krishna Dikshari Sikshanam Vishram Vena Guru Seva Sadhu Vagmanu Vartante. One, accepting the shelter of the lotus feet of a bona fide spiritual master. Two, become initiated by the spiritual master and learning how to discharge devotional service from him. Three, obeying the orders of the spiritual master with faith and devotion. And four, following the footsteps of great acharyas, teachers, under the direction of the spiritual master. Bhakti Rasami Kasinda 1.2.74. One who has executed these preliminary duties is qualified to relish Srimad Bhagavatam. When one actually hears the sound vibration of Srimad Bhagavatam, as it is, Yasyam Vai Sru Yamanaya Krishne Paramapurushe Bhakti Utpadya Te Pumsa Soka Moha Vadai Paha. Simply by giving oral reception to the Srimad Bhagavatam, the feeling for loving devotional service to Lord Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Sprouts up at once to extinguish the fire of lamentation, illusion, fearfulness. Bhagavatam 1.7.7. One should hear Srimad Bhagavatam from a bona fide spiritual master who can expertly engage that propensity for loving Krishna that arises from hearing the Srimad Bhagavatam in his transcendental sound. Such a transcendental, unauthorized engagement is called Bhagavat. Dharma, within the interaction side of the Krishna consciousness, there are many thousands of oral varieties. Within the interaction side of the Krishna consciousness, there are many thousands of authorized engagements pertaining to the society's missionary activities. And by hearing the Srimad Bhagavatam and performing such engagements, society members feel relief from soka, lamentation, moha, illusion, and bhaya, fear. According to Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, those who have achieved a more mature understanding. According to Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, those who have achieved a mature understanding of the transcendental sound vibration of Srimad Bhagavatam may adopt the order of Dandi Sannyas. As described in the Hamsa Gita, 13th chapter of this canto, a so-called Vaishnava who simply neglects the strict control of the body, mind, and speech cannot actually achieve shelter at the lotus feet, even if such whimsical sense enjoyer makes a show of assuming the dress and danda Vaishnava Sannyas, he will not attain the desired result, love of Krishna. A bona fide Vaishnava should work earnestly to free himself from any tinge of sense gratification and mental speculation, and with a loving heart, and with a loving heart, he should always carry out the orders of his bona fide spiritual master. Always remembering the exalted position of the bona fide spiritual master, the disciple will achieve shelter in the lotus feet of Lord Krishna, thus in the heart of Bhagavatam, 11th canto, 3rd chapter, 22nd verse. Tatra Bhagavatam Dharman Shikshet Urvatma Daivatam. Amayaya Anu Vritya Yains Tusya Atmatma Dohari. So the previous verse it said how we should accept our Guru. And this verse it says once you've accepted a Guru, then you should accept him as life and soul and worship will be. How many have accepted Guru? How many are aspiring to accept Guru? So learn from the Guru how to render devotional service. Serve the Guru like a deity. It doesn't mean that Guru is Krishna. He's a devotee of Krishna, but we respect him like a deity, because Krishna has said to do so here in the Bhagavatam, because he's very dear to Krishna. If you surrender to Guru and serve him, then Hari, who's in the heart of everyone, is the Paramatma. He likes to give himself to his pure devotees. You can win over Lord Krishna by surrendering to Guru. One day, Lord Chaitanya went to see, this happened to meet Srivas Thakur. And Lord Chaitanya asked Srivas, and they started to instruct him, Srivas, why are you associating with this Lord Nityananda? This Lord Nityananda, he acts in a very strange way. He's avadut. Sometimes he's running with the children, sometimes he's jumping in the Ganges. I mean, he's unpredictable. You are a very prestigious brahmana in this society. What will people think if you associate with someone who is so unpredictable? So much of an avadut. Your reputation as a very reputed brahmana will be hampered. Better you don't associate with Nityananda Prabhu if you are concerned about all these things. Srivas Thakur was shocked. So why am I hearing these things from you, Lord Chaitanya? Why are you testing me like this? I have full faith in Lord Nityananda. Even if I see him come out from some sinful place, I know that he's been there for some Krishna conscious purpose. I don't have any doubt. So then, saying that, and because of your devotion to Lord Nityananda, you have purified yours. You can do with me as you like. If you want to put me out for sale in the market, how are you who wants to buy Lord Chaitanya here? But you can sell. I know yours. So, because Nityananda Prabhu is so dear to the Lord, and because Srivas Thakur sold himself out to Lord Nityananda, then Lord Chaitanya gave himself to Srivas Thakur. that is very esoteric, very big secret. If you give yourself to Krishna, devotee, Krishna gives himself to you. Because Guru is Krishna's representative, so how do you deal with Guru? Then Lord Krishna, he accepts that. You deal with the Guru very poorly, and Krishna also will not be pleased with you. If you serve the Guru, the Vaishnavas, very nicely. This is a very amazing thing. This verse confirms it, just like Bali Maharaj. He gave everything to the Lord. So the Lord reciprocated and gave himself to Bali. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu Chaitanya Sudayam Jamina. You can't get Krishna by force. You can't kidnap somebody and hold them ransom for Krishna to come to give him some. There's no way you can defeat Krishna. He's Ajita. Aparajita can never be defeated. And when the Lord sees that how faithful and sincere the disciple is, that being satisfied, he offers himself to the disciple. So Prabhupada was asked, how can we get Krishna? How can we find him? And Srila Prabhupada was saying how by carrying out the orders of the Guru and the previous acharyas, this way one can get Krishna. But then Prabhupada would also reply that don't try to look for Krishna, don't try to seek him. Try to do such nice devotional service that Krishna will want to see this devotee. Where is that devotee who is serving me so nicely, assisting my dear devotee? That's the secret for success, to serve Krishna in such a way that he's so pleased. Easy way, it's hard to please Krishna. Why? Other because if you want to give him something, he has already everything. Prabhupada said it's very hard to give something to a rich man that they appreciate, but if you make friends with their daughter or their son, then they become very pleased. So Bali Maharaj, he surrendered. Bali is also the king of Kerala. Comes in Oman. Ona festival to see all the prajas. So there's some connection here, right? Any other part of India celebrates Onam? Only the Malayans. Would any other community celebrate? Spreading, but seeds, some connection is there, right? Bali Maharaj, he was successful because he gave everything to Krishna. So then Krishna reciprocated, gave everything south to the devotee. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Chaitanya Sadaiva Jamina. According to how you approach Krishna, you reciprocate. So somebody gives everything to Krishna's representative. Then Krishna reciprocates and gives himself to that devotee. Like Bali, he was also following his guru, Sukracharya, because he faithfully followed his guru and because Indra had offended his guru. Indra had committed an offense against his own guru. Sometimes Indra commits offenses. He sees the guru every day, guru is coming. When you don't see the guru every day, then when he comes, maybe you're more careful. Guru Dev! Harivo! But then sometimes, if you see too much, then you don't say Guru Dev anymore. Guru Dev. So, Mani Maharaj, he was keeping watch what Indra was doing. So one day, Indra was seated on the throne and everyone's praising him. Glories to Indra Dev! Glories to Indra, the great warrior, the king of the three worlds, Indra Dev Ki! Meanwhile, his guru walks in, Brihaspati. Indra looks at the guru, but he didn't. Guru walks, you should stand up, or you should take pranam, you should offer some kind of respect. But like, all right, guru, amen. Yes, tell me some more. Indra Dev Ki! Then the guru looked and said, aha. Now it doesn't matter if I come or go. He's not offering any respect, so let me go. So then he disappeared. Immediately Indra realized I committed an offense. When we see the guru, we have to offer pranam. I didn't offer any pranam. He started told everybody publicly, you see, oh, what does this position do? What does this false pride do? It makes one commit offenses. And I just committed offense to my guru. And he said, find him, we must beg him for forgiveness. But Brihaspati was so expert, he couldn't be found. So they're looking everywhere for him, but they couldn't find him. Where he went. It could be anywhere in the universe. And they couldn't find him. He is also more powerful than Indra. So then Bali Maharaj, he got the news. That this Indra is maybe getting some of the leelas mixed up. And Bali found out that this happened 2-3 times and they offended his guru and then maybe different Indras. But Bali knows this is the time. He doesn't have a guru to guide him. He's weak now. So they attacked. Indra was defeated. So a little mistake cost him everything. Because he became too proud. But Guru has to always remember that he is servant of Krishna. Ramaharshana was seated on the asana to give Bhagavatam class. And Balaram himself comes. All the sages are sitting like this and Balaram comes. So Ramaharsha looks, Balaram. Anyway, I'm speaking of Bhagavatam, I don't have to give respect to anybody. But there's some exception. If Krishna himself comes in, or the Guru won't get up, I'm giving Bhagavatam. I don't. Other sages come in, you don't have to get up. But if your Krishna himself comes, Balaram comes, you have to get up. So Balaram said, this guy is too puffed up. He's not qualified to be the guru for all these people. So They came and just took one kusa grass and touches Ramaharshana. Ramaharshana is dead. Everybody was shocked. Balaram just took his life. He said, Lord, you took our guru who's teaching us, then how we can learn the science? So then, that's how Suta Goswami, the son of Ramaharshana, he got stoned. Someone may be a guru or a teacher, but then if they are in a very big position, they offend their guru or they offend Krishna because of false pride, then they can lose everything. They have to always be very humble in relation to the spiritual master. Spiritual master is called as Guru, Deva, Guru Maharaja, Acharya Deva, such type of addresses. Generally we don't call Guru by name, just like in India you don't call your father by name. So your name father is in Gopal, you don't say Gopal. Even in, as a child in the West, I was taught the same thing. Never call your mother or father by their name. Always say mother or father or daddy, mommy, whatever, mama, mommy. So, even in a civil, in a, somehow that Vedic culture is still even in the West. But now I see in the West some younger people, they call their parents by their name. But this time, sometimes you have to say the name of the guru. Say someone asks, who is your guru? He says, even if you refer, you can say the name of your guru. But then he said, you should say with the folded hands, my spiritual master is His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta, O Vishnupada. You say, O Vishnupada. And touch your hand to your forehead. My guru name is O Vishnupada. So, Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. It's so etiquette, how one should act. Srila Gurudev, Srila Guru Maharaj, like this you address. For any sannyasi, you say Maharaj. And for any initiated devotee in good standing, you call him as Prabhu. Sometimes a new devotee, you can tell who's a new person. Because they always come up to some Maharaj and say, Prabhu. They haven't learned the etiquette, nobody taught them. We don't say Prabhu to a sannyasi. It's for the non-sannyasi. Some disciple will come up and to the Gurudev he says, Maharaj. Maharaj is for all the sannyasis. There's so many sannyasis. But your own spiritual masters, you call it Gurudev or Guru Maharaj. If you just say Maharaj, it's like you're not my guru. You're just one of the Maharajas. Sometimes even the Siksha Guru or some very respected guru, even may not be someone's Diksha Guru, sometimes the devotees also say, yes, Guru Maharaj. Just out of respect. I also respect you as a Guru Maharaj, you are a member of my Guru. That's very endearing. Maharaj is respectful, but it's not so endearing. Prabhu is respectful. So there's like some etiquette. How we deal with the Guru, with the Vaishnavas. Just like in the West, like when people are, they're taught in India, be with your right hand, right? That's the normal procedure. It's like from childhood, when you use with the right hand, nobody uses with the left hand. So. Jerusalem, the city of heaven. But in the West, they don't know all these things. They have to learn everything. Plus, they say, why not? What's the difference? The world is saying five things. He had to convince them. But sometimes there's some new devotee in the temple. They don't know, and then maybe Sunday feast or something. Used to be that some old devotee, little cranky kind, he'd come up and somebody gets maybe eating with the left hand, shout at him, "Why are you eating with the left hand?" And the person like the heart is like, "I don't know, left, right, what's left? What did I do? Come on. And then they run off, you know, never come back again. Why are these people shouting and scaring me like anything? I don't understand left or right, nothing. So now we're training that people don't shout at the people, don't get angry, don't scare them, you know. You can explain though. You like sitting in the temple, people put their foot out to the deity sometime in the West, they don't know. Generally in India they know, but in the West they don't know these things. They say, "Oh, here we don't show the feet to the deity, you know, your guests." Tell the little audience, you know, it's considered the more clean, you know, to use your right hand and then eating and that was the prasadam and it's our culture. Sometimes, you know, they get people get frightened if they're too heavy with them. So you have to be also how to teach somebody, how to tell them nicely, patiently, so that they can get the true understanding. The disciple also has to use the common sense. Disciples also doesn't apply the mind. One time the guru, after eating, he said, "You know, I want some harikatha." And so, the person took the harikatha, one of the three, and he took open and gave that guru the seed. So why do you give him a seed? What the outside is like, it looks like a date. So then, so I don't know guru day, I thought, you know, maybe the seed is like mostly herbs, the seed. Okay, next time I'll give you the outside. The next time that guru said, "Give me one milachi." So then he took the lychee, threw away the seed and gave that cover. So what are you doing? He told me last time to give you the cover, and give me the cover. No, but the lychee, you take the seed. Like Gurudev, they're so complicated, every time something different. So we have to also learn what is the use of each thing and what is the part. How to apply. So there's many little things like that in devotional service. It seems very simple, but there's hundreds of little things one has to gradually pick up. No use of getting, one patiently has to instruct. How will the disciple know? That's why in bhakti, the purpose of something is more important. If you know the principle behind it, then you can apply them. Principle is what is useful part of them. Haritaki, the useful part is the fruit part. But in a cardamom, the useful part is the seed. So then according to the useful aspect of different kinds of herbs, you take that. So this was why we try to sometimes explain the reason behind. You could not see that wine. Because we're dedicating our body as a temple. Each of the tilak mantras we put with the mantra of Vishnu. Keshavaya namah, Narayanaya namah, Madhavaya namah, Govindaya namah, Vishnavaya namah, Manasudaya namah, Trivikramaya namah, Vamanaya namah, Sridharaya namah, Rishikeshaya namah, Padmanavaya namah, Damanaraya namah, Vasudevaya namah. So 12 plus 1. So this also protects us. We are normally controlled by the karmas. So we put on tilak, it puts us under Krishna's protection. There's a whole chapter in Padma Purana, Gopi Chandana Mahatmya. That if you wear the tilak and how even somebody sees you, they can be freed from sins. How this is very powerful practice, because this tilak, pundra pundra, is worn in the spiritual world. So when you see that, it reminds you of your original position in the spiritual world. It awakens that soul. I told the devotees that how the very first time that I saw a tilak, for me it was a very frightening, shocking kind of a situation. I was a young person going to a public festival in San Francisco, Golden Gate Park. There was a group of devotees chanting. I didn't know who they were. I saw some people look like they're wearing pink bed sheets, from my perspective. And they're ladies and men, and they were singing with the cymbals and the drums. So I was really attracted, and I started walking over to see what is going on there. As I came close, one lady turned and looked at me. She had a very pronounced tilak on her. When she looked, all I saw was that tilak. When I saw that, all the hairs on my body, they stood on end, and I felt like an electrical shock up my back. And I became so frightened, so shocked, I just ran as fast as I could the other way. And about 2 kilometers later, then I trained my intelligence and saying, why are you running? What's happening? Why did that symbol on the forehead make such an effect on you? Because this was all going beyond my mind and intelligence. It was like a completely spontaneous reaction. It's like an awakening. So then I decided to go back, find out who these people are, why this happened to me. And I went back and those devotees were gone. I was looking and looking for the devotees. Took me some time to find them again. Nobody, oh, those are Hare Krishnas. Where are they? I don't know. They come and sing in the park. Nobody could tell me. So I was looking. So, Prabhupada said that the previous life I was a devotee. So maybe that first time I saw the tilak, shock on my car. I don't know, I don't have the explanation why. But I really appreciate how tilak is a very powerful thing. And as Padma Purana says, it's a very, very powerful. Just putting the tilak on, seeing that tilak, it actually is a very purifying. The Prabhupada, he stressed, you don't just put on the tilak without the mantra. It's not like we're Adivasis putting on some war paint, you know, tribals or something. It's a very highly elevated science how to put on these things. We call this the science of living. How to live in a spiritual, applied, technological way. This Krishna consciousness is applied technology of spiritual practices, known as sadhana bhakti. So we need to learn this applied technology, the science of living. If you know this science, then you can finish up in one lifetime and go back to God. Some people know the art of living, how to live in this material world and stay here birth after birth. But we know the science of how to live and make it the final life. So this is very important. So part of it, all these little practices, we learn this from the guru and his representative. What is a tilak, how to offer prasadam, how to perform archana to the deities, how to study the shastra, how to understand what the scripture means, how to chant japa. So many things are there to learn. So part of that, how to respect the guru, how to serve the guru. Whenever we see a Maharaj first time in the day, we should pay obeisances. So whenever we see the Guru, we should pay obeisances. Otherwise, the Vaishnavas, we all pay once a day, one chakal, patrubhyas, chakita, simbhubi, which are in the name of Vaishnavas. So like that, there's a different standard. So this is called Vaishnava etiquette. Vaishnava Vyavahar in Sanskrit. So if we learn that, then it's possible to develop love for Krishna. If we don't know how to deal, we don't know how to act, and if we commit offenses, the Vaishnava etiquette is what protects us from committing offenses. So Guru shouldn't reject that disciple very easily, because if he rejects, how does it help the disciple? Disciple will be lost. The Guru tries to save that disciple. Sometimes if a disciple is creating very big disturbance and infecting other disciples with envious thought, that disciple may have to be separated, exiled. Like now they have S-A-R-S, panic, this ailment, or concern all over the world. When you arrive here in Bahrain, you have to fill out one declaration, whether you have been recently in Hong Kong, Singapore, China, a few places like that, where this SARS has come out. As they're trying to stop the spread, if you say, if you had been in those places, they're going to keep you locked up for 10 days. It's pretty heavy, actually. Even you don't have any symptoms. At least in other places, you have to show that symptom. In India, they also make you fill out a declaration, but you have to show the symptom, then they'll quarantine you. Here, that travel agent told me that if you just come in that country, they'll keep you under observation for 10 days. Maybe you'll be in the same room as someone who has it. So, this quarantine system is there. So also in spiritual life, there's also such a possibility that if a disciple is become very destructive for other disciples, then you have to quarantine that disciple, because that disciple will spoil the other one. Otherwise, if they're not that bad, then normally we don't reject them. We don't try to separate them. We just try to preach to them and change them. This is the system. Now, Shastra said that the Guru can't quarantine a disciple and say, don't associate in some rare case. Very destructive disciple. There was once one disciple called Nitaidas in Vrindavan, and he was going and visiting all other groups. He said he liked to hear different classes and different things. What's wrong? They're all Vaishnavas, they're all devotees. But there are many other philosophies, and if you start hearing different philosophies, sometimes you can get confused. So this is what happened with him. He got confused and deviated from the strict path of Krishna consciousness. So then, not in a gross sense, not like he was breaking principles, but philosophically. Then he started to criticize, telling devotees they should go out and listen to some other guru, and started to criticize in different ways. Prabhupada, maybe he also went out and took some other initiation without permission. So then Prabhupada said that this Nitaidas, he became a snake. He should go out and stay out. But he should associate with him. Because now he's criticizing and trying to take people away. So such a danger can be there. Leaders have to beware if somebody becomes very offensive. answer to the Guru Parampara preaching in such a way that people lose their faith in Krishna consciousness. It's very dangerous to reject one's bona fide Guru. But especially in some of these holy dhams, there are certain people, they are expert how to win the confidence and how to steal away the faith of the people. Even when they start off praising, oh yes, I know your guru, he's very nice, he said that. Then you think, oh, he's a friend, so you open up and you talk. Then later they change their tune. One has to be quite careful before we, outside of the ISKCON community, before we listen to other people, for the ISKCON devotees. We have to be sure that that person is valid. Because if we hear from a non-Vaishnava or someone who's giving un-Vaishnava discussions, even though it's the name of Krishna conscious discussions, that can have a poisonous effect. Vaishnava bhagavad girnam putam haripatamitam sravanam naiva kartavyam sarva chishtamatapayam. Just like if milk is touched by the lips of a serpent, you won't drink that milk. Even if some non-devotee speaks about haripata, which is nectar, but when he speaks, the poison. The non-devotees, they always end with some merging or some either sahaja or mayavadi. Mayavadi is easy to figure out, more easy. The sahaja is more difficult. Sahaja means it's too cheap, the process of achieving Krishna. So both these two things are dangerous for the devotees. We want to follow this process given by Lord Chaitanya, sadhana bhakti. Do the sadhana bhakti, develop our natural attraction for Krishna, everything. Serve the spiritual master, work under his guidance. Learn from him the process. And how we learn means that so many assistants may be teaching, but if there's something you have a doubt about, whether that is correct or not, then we check it with the guru. Now there are some persons who are telling that you should chant Gauranga Japas, Nityananda Japas, on the beads. And they're trying to, they get the confidence very good that you increase your taste. And so I'll give you a special additional initiation in Gauranga Mantra. But then there was no such system that Prabhupada authorized his disciples should get additional initiation. And he specifically said that this is nonsense to chant Panchatattva Mantra on the beads. But some people are now saying, well, that's Panchatattva Gauranga Mantra, he never said. The point is, beads are for the Hare Krishna Mahamantra. That's our regular practice. We chant before, we say before, it always says that Gauranga Daki. Call out on the name of Gauranga. We don't have to stand silent. We have to shout out. Gauranga! Nityananda! Some people have said, no, no, they keep trying to introduce some new idea. So see, we're getting the new secret. Sex. No one else knew before, you have to chant Hare Krishna, Gauranga Mantra. So we know this, so now we're telling you. Then, this way they try to get over some disciples. Everyone knows they should chant Gauranga, but that doesn't mean you start suddenly having to chant Japa Mala and stuff like that. You chant Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Adaita Gada Nada Shiva Sali Gaur Bhakta Vrinda. You chant like that. One time or more before we chant, we go. Let me chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare,
Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare
Hare. So usually what different gurus try to do is that they try to repackage the same thing in some new way and make it seem more attractive for the people. But we have to see whether in the packaging they are leaving out something or adding something or changing something. Packaging is one thing, but whether the substance is the same or not. That's what we learn from our guru, whether it's suitable or not. We learn whether it's suitable from sadhu, shastra, and guru. We check things, we verify, we don't do things blindly. If we're not sure, it seems to be against shastra, against what other devotees are doing, then we should consult with our spiritual master. So I hope all of you like this learn the science of Krishna consciousness very nicely. Any questions, I'm always there to help. Want to see you all get back to Krishna in this lifetime. Want you to be very happy in Krishna consciousness. Sometimes we're not happy because we're still not 100% Krishna conscious. We're somewhat still in the material point of view. And so this requires some anxieties for us. But if we become more and more Krishna conscious, then we can cross over all these kind of tests. Material world is sukha dukkha da. Always changing. Like the Siddhoshna, sukha dukkha da. From summer to winter, now it's the hot weather. Starting in some places, it's already 40 plus. Yesterday was very cool. Today is warming up. So like that. Sometimes it's the winter, it gets cold. In the material world, things change, but we have to be fixed in the spiritual vision. Then these changes we can tolerate. We can adjust, we can take precautions. That's not the basis for our happiness. We're happy because of serving Krishna. And materially we are. What's the word I want to use? Surviving. Finish up our life in a peaceful way. There'll be some happiness, there'll be some tests. And if more you can develop your Krishna consciousness, then you'll be spiritually satisfied.
Hare Krishna,
Krishna
Krishna,
Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Any question, any doubt? So how was the etiquette between Krishna and Balaram? Balaram is older, but Krishna is the Supreme Personality of God. See, Krishna's lila, he would tend to interchange his obeisances and respects in accordance with the external relation. So he would, Balarama's older brother by 1 year, so he treated like older brother under normal circumstances. Sometimes Balaram, he was in the mood of protecting his younger brother, he tried to protect Krishna always. Only Balaram and Krishna know who's over. So if Krishna wanted to, he would overrule Balaram. But that externally it appeared that the normal things that the Balaram was treating him like younger brother with great love and affection, and Krishna was treating him like an old brother. Little older, that's how much older, to be honest. So when Krishna would come into Dwarka, says that different people like he touched the feet of the elders. He would hold the hand or embrace at his equals, depending on how their relationship. He blessed the junior. He's playing the role as a Kshatriya king in Bharatam. Narada Muni came. He he was bathed at the feet of Narada. Even when his Brahmana schoolmate, Vipul Sudama, came, he bathed his feet. So they were friends, so. Was Kshatriya giving a formal reception to Ramana, they sat down as friends and they were discussing, how are you, how are things, how is your wife, how many children you have, just like friends. And then with Sudama, he was so much overwhelmed by how versatile and kind Krishna was, remembering his old friend, he sees his youth, opulence and the palatial buildings and everything, goddess of fortune. And Krishna says, you brought something for me. He saw that he had a little packet of his cheap rice. But then with Sudama, he thought, what can I give this to Krishna? What Krishna's got so much after, what do you do with this rotten, lousy cheap rice? So no, it's not good enough to do. I don't have anything good enough to give to you. No, anything that's good enough for my devotee is good enough for me, let me see. And you know, we know how by force he grabbed it and took out one bite, two bites, and Lakshmi stopped him and said, no more please. You take three bites, I'm not gonna retain you. So these external situations, and that Krishna acts according to that in his lila. He's playing a particular role, and Ram, respecting his father Dasarath, and the father said, go to the forest for things and just love him, whatever he's saying.
Thank you for watching our videos. Be sure to subscribe to our channel. We publish new videos every day, and don't forget to like and share our channel.